Some people are worried about eating meat or animal products because they're concerned that the animal may have been injected with growth hormones and that there may be some residue from those growth hormones that they then ingest when they eat the food, and it could have some effect on them. Some people are worried about antibiotics, that the cows or the animals that have been injected with antibiotics, and there could be some knock-on effect on them. So I'm going to talk about those concerns. We're going to talk about the growth hormones and the antibiotics, why they're used, when they're used, which parts of the world they're used in, what the controls are, and what the implications are to you. So if you are a carnivore, or you're interested in a carnivore diet, or you know someone on a carnivore diet, or you're afraid of eating animal products, you need to understand the real truth about growth hormones and antibiotics in the animals so that you can make your own decisions. Okay, welcome to ShapeFixer. I am Andrew. I am a nutritionist and a biologist. So let's go with this. Right, the first thing is why. Why are animals sometimes administered either growth hormones or antibiotics, or both? I'm going to cover them separately. The first thing is, a growth hormone is a chemical produced naturally by all animals to facilitate growth and the development of new tissue. So if it's naturally occurring in the animal, why would it be injected into the animal? And the answer is very simple. The idea behind it is to raise the level of growth hormone so that the animal grows more quickly, produces more muscle. It speeds up the time that it takes for the animal to reach maturity and to make it available as a food source, which it also converts its food more efficiently into meat, and all that makes the production, brings the production cost down. So actually makes the food cheaper for the end customer. Now, that's not necessarily a good enough argument to just ignore any potential health issues. But these hormones, remember, are naturally occurring in the animal. So really what you're doing is you're increasing the level of these chemicals unnaturally, really. They'll be higher than they would normally be. So we'll get back to that. Why would we inject animals with antibiotics? Clearly to overcome disease, to make sure the meat is healthy, so the animals stay healthy. So there are laws in most countries around when you can inject with antibiotics, when you can inject with growth hormones, how long you have to wait before the meat becomes approved for eating. So let's talk about that. In the USA, there is very strict control about the administration of growth hormone. It is controlled by vets, certified veterinary surgeons that have to inspect the herds on a regular basis. There are limits in terms of which chemical they can use, how often they can use it, how long they have to wait for the residue level to go back down before the animal is sent for slaughter. And that is overseen by the Food and Drug Administration. So there are systems in place to make sure that that there's no excessive growth hormone in the meat that you eat. Now, the level of growth hormone that you produce in your body far exceeds any hormone that would be in your meat, whether it's natural hormone in the meat or whether it's been boosted by injection. So that's something for you to understand. But there are laws around it. Now, you may say, I don't trust the laws, I don't trust the FDA, I don't trust the vets, everybody's corrupt, there's no guarantee that just because there are rules that people are abiding by the rules. And that, of course, is possibly true. But if that's your concern, then you need to have the same concern about the plants, because there are also a lot of rules and controls in place around fertilizing plants and using pesticides, and to avoid a buildup of unnatural toxins in the plant food. And if you don't trust the authorities to regulate the meat according to the law, then why would you trust them to regulate the plant industry, the agriculture, according to the law? So now you've got yourself into a different situation where it's not about meat and growth hormones, it's around toxins and law. So you need to then, as much as possible, know where your food is coming from. Look for organic food, food that has not been tampered with, animals and plants that have not been given artificial fertilizers or growth hormones or antibiotics, but then also understand that you run the risk of eating something that does have an infection and can make you sick. So you've got a bit of a minefield to navigate here. So this isn't about growth hormones and antibiotics in meat specifically. This is about whether or not you trust that the government is regulating your food supply or not. In Europe, in the EU, growth hormones are actually just banned. And again, you've got to trust that nobody's going under the legal radar, but at least they are banned in animals. And that is not because there's been some kind of conclusive proof that it's a problem. It's more out of the awareness that there is so much public concern that it's easier to just say, okay, you know what? We're not going to do it. Nobody's allowed to do it. Fine. Now there isn't the same level of concern. When it comes to antibiotics, the regulations are quite strict about only using antibiotics on an animal that is sick to make help the animal get better. And again, it's administered by a vet, it's monitored by a vet, and there is a delay time between the administrating of an antibiotic and the actual slaughtering of the animal to make sure that the antibiotic level comes back down. The reason you may not inject antibiotics into a whole herd as a sort of preventative measure, which was way back a common practice, is because just as the overuse of antibiotics in humans, it would lead to the development of antibiotic-resistant bacteria, and you'd end up with animals that do carry pathogens and bacteria, which can possibly make you sick when you eat the meat. So there's a reason for controlling that. So a lot of antibiotic, it's not the antibiotic itself that is a problem, it's the fact that too much antibiotic can lead to the development of stronger pathogens or disease-inducing bacteria. The laws are very, very strict. So wherever you live in the world, the best is to find out how it works in your country. You would have a feel for whether or not it's the type of country where laws are adhered to or not. If possible, know where your actual meat is coming from. Within the constraints of what's available, and you know, you may not have access to organic food, but understand that this is really an issue about control and trust in the mechanisms of control. So whether that applies to meat or whether that applies to plants and fertilizers and toxic and insecticides and pesticides, all being equal, if you don't trust anything, you're going to find it very difficult to find anything to eat. Or if you do trust the system, then both plants and animals, you want to think, well, the regulation is going to at least keep it reasonably risk-free from that point of view. So what you've then got to look at is, what do I need to be eating? What food is more nutritious? Should I be on a plant-based diet or should I be on an animal-based diet? And then you're going back into nutrition biology. And I'm going to link some videos below here about the hidden dangers of a plant diet that a lot of people don't realize. The toxins that are naturally in the plants, never mind added, natural toxins, natural anti-nutrients in plants. And to what level do you actually need a lot of plants in your diet anyway? I would say you don't. You don't need fiber. We've done videos on that. There are no nutrients in plants that you cannot get in animal food. So if you are carnivore curious, or somebody near you is on a carnivore diet, or you're trending towards a ketogenic carnivore diet or ketovore, lots of terminology for this stuff, the idea of growth hormones and antibiotics in the meat is not enough on its own to drive you to a plant-based diet. It's actually quite irrational. You need to understand what the controls are, and you need to understand what the risks are of fertilizers and pesticides that are added to the soil or sprayed onto the plants that you're eating. So you've got this concern and this issue on both sides of the dietary spectrum. It applies to plants just as much as it does to animals, in as much as there may or may not be any risk. So it all comes back to nutrition and diet and what you should really be eating. A proper diet, a proper healthy human diet, is an animal-based diet. Now, you don't have to be total carnivore if you find that complicated, but you can be, because it's perfectly good for you and you will get all the nutrition you want. Okay, thank you for liking this video. Thank you for sharing it. Thank you for subscribing to our channel. And watch the other videos that I'm going to link below here to give you a little more insight into carnivore diets, into plant-based diets, and some information that you might not have known about. And I'm sorry if it makes you uncomfortable, but keep an open mind and really understand the science so that you're better placed to make the right decisions that will affect your health.